Pokemon will have get to go first. And so, don't worry, I won't eat your soul right now.
So if y'all have a question, please, first of all, being civil and being professional is key here. So everyone can get their questions in. Q&A is going to go up to 7:30, so this is like, we have to be very efficient here. One thing that this room does not have is like secondary microphones. So what we're going to do is, if I can have two people line up on each row, and then we're just going to alternate back and forth. After one person asks a question, you can sit, and then someone else in like this half, for example, can get behind. Don't fight. Like, we're going to get to everyone, hopefully.
And if you can't hear the questions, I'll repeat them on the mic so people can hear.
Exactly. So if you all can hold the line, we'll start on this half.
Okay, you were quick. Go for it.
Hi, I'm a member of YCT. Thank you for coming to our campus, first of all. I've been thinking about the question I was going to ask you for a couple of days now, and I figured I'd ask something that you may not have been asked before. I like to pride myself on being probably the most right person in this room. And so, when it comes to
second most right today, go ahead.
When it comes to the issue of Black Lives Matter, I've looked at the statistics, and I, by and large, understand the arguments against most of the things they say. But when it comes to the issue of a government's responsibility to interface with their citizens in a way that they feel protected by it, do you think that the group has an argument there?
Well, I mean, I think that the idea that the government does not do that, that's what a democracy is. I mean, the idea that the police aren't talking to citizens is a misread of what the police actually do. It's not like the police pull up in headquarters and then they just run out and just attack people. That's not how the police work. So there is a feedback mechanism, and in a democracy, in a republic, there is a feedback mechanism that does exist. If people aren't listening properly, then that's something that we can work on. But the problem I have with Black Lives Matter is they base their false assumptions about what the police are on not listening to the police or recognizing what the police are. They say that the police, they're not worried about the police listening, they're worried about the police actually policing. They think that the police in arresting people who commit crimes are doing something deeply wrong if they're not arresting people by race. If there are too many Black people being arrested, then the police are racist and doing something that's deeply evil and wrong. That's the problem I have with Black Lives Matter. I don't have any problem with people who want to talk to the cops. I don't think the cops have any problem with people who want to talk to them. I think they have more problems with the people who are pushing the notion that cops are racist and blowing away people for no good reason, and they have a real problem with people who are rioting in cities based on that false logic.
Thank you.
Okay, so my question is a little bit different from the main topic that we're talking about.
Yeah, anyway.
So I'm sure you've heard about what happened to Brock Turner this summer. And
yeah, it's Hanford.
Yeah.
I'll admit I didn't follow it super closely, but probably.
But after this happened and like all the backlash against it, Stanford passed a rule that like they can't have any hard alcohol on campus, like in the parties anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So like, what do you think of that? Like their ruling and like.
I mean, I think I think it's a stupid prophylactic measure. I mean, I think that. You know, the idea that anybody who has hard alcohol is then going to become a rapist is bizarre to me. We already have laws against rape, it turns out. We already have laws against sexual assault. And if people want to get drunk, it's not something that I'm very much for, but it's also not something that I think the government has a role in, or the university really has a strong role in, unless it's actually endangering people. Like, if there's a bout of alcohol poisoning, and you personally are one of the people who poisoned yourself, and now they want to suspend you, then the university is a private university, can set its own rules. But I think that these sort of we're going to stop rape by stopping people from drinking. You're big boys and big girls. I think that you're capable of making decisions for yourself, and I think that we're all capable of saying people who rape are bad,
yeah,
regardless of how much alcohol they have in their system.
So you don't think that like it's actually going to have an effect on like rape?
No, I don't think that rapists rape people because they're drunk. I think rapists rape people because they're rapists.
Hi, huge fan. you said in one of your talks, I think the fundamental problem is we as Americans, we need a moral reawakening.
Yes.
And I absolutely agree with that. And I think kind of that was what the core of your talk and your arguments really are, is, hey, this is what is morally right, obviously. And this is what is morally wrong, obviously. Mm-hmm. agree with that. But what I've come to experience, and I just kind of wanted to get your opinion on, is those arguments, this is what is obviously moral against this is what is obviously immoral. When we're talking to these you know, people of the left, they will simply disagree. They will simply just disagree. And what I kind of want to bring it back to is it's really, in my opinion, more of a philosophical
issue. No, it's definitely a philosophical difference. Yeah.
It's really the idea or the concept of
the
objectivity of morality.
Yeah, and I agree. I think there's a serious values difference that has broken out in this country since the 1960s. And that can't be obscured, and it can't be glossed over with friendly words about how we all want the same thing. We don't all want the same thing. This is why I'm very harsh on the, I say it's a nasty, evil concept, this idea of the government imposing fairness of outcome on people, or that it's the job of the collective to do that in violation of individual rights. The thing is, I think most people, down deep, and if I didn't believe this, then I wouldn't think there's a future to politics. I do think that down deep, most people understand that individual rights need to trump the collective desire to harm your individual rights for the gain of the collective. If people didn't believe that, then there really wouldn't be hope for the country. But people don't even have it presented in those ways. One of the things that bothers me about how people on the right present political arguments is they're constantly talking about what politics works and what works and what doesn't. It's kind of the Paul Ryan approach to politics, right? If we do entitlement reform, this many people will be saved on Social Security. If we don't, this many people won't. And that, to me, is almost it's a secondary argument. You first have to discuss what is the role of government in people's lives. We first have to discuss what is right and wrong, and we have to reteach that from the most basic level. And so that's going to start with teaching our kids, our own kids, at the most basic level. I have two. I have one that's 2.5 and one that's 6 months, and it's going to start with me teaching them at the most basic level. But it's also going to be challenging the left's feeling of unearned moral superiority. People on the left feel, the things they say are very stupid sometimes, but they feel good about what they're saying, and that's the only thing that matters. Like Bernie Sanders' acolytes, it never occurs to them that they're stealing other people's money, that you are voting to literally take somebody else's labor and time from them. Right? They say, oh no, I'm fair, I'm making a better person, because I'm willing to give up. Well, no, you're not willing to give up. If you're willing to give up, you just give charity. You're willing for me to give up by taking the government gun, pointing it at my head, and saying, me and my friends vote for you to give me your money. Right? You don't get to do that. That makes you an ass. And the fact is that if we don't argue in those terms and force people on the left to confront the roots of their own morality, you're never going to come to the point where we can even have an argument about values. The part of the thing that just annoys me about values, about political discussion, is politics is like an iceberg, and everybody's always discussing at the tip of the iceberg, and 90% of the iceberg is underwater. We need to be discussing the stuff that's underwater. Sorry, I have your...
Really, what the point was, was discussing what that root is, and that's why I'm kind of bringing up the belief, or really just the general concept of God in someone's life.
Well, listen, if the Yarmulke didn't indicate it, I'm a very religious person. So I believe deeply in the basis of Judeo-Christian morality, and that's why on a social level, not on a governmental level, government has no business in this, a free government can only exist when people are moral, right? Everybody from Tocqueville to Adams says this. And so you're going to need churches and synagogues to do a better job of inculcating values in the kids they teach, as opposed to, here's some guitar music and pizza, come to church on Sundays. It's a waste of time, it doesn't teach anybody anything, and they do it at synagogues too, so it's not unique to Christians. And it's ripped the heart out of religion and made it meaningless. And unless religion can regain its footing as a moral arbiter and a speaker for eternal values, then why would anybody waste their Sunday going to church for pizza and guitar when you can stay home and have pizza and not listen to a preacher? Seems a lot better to me. Right? I pray 3 times a day. If I didn't believe there were eternal values behind that, I would certainly not waste my time doing that.
Hi, so I'm someone, my name's Sai, and I swing towards the leftist a little bit sometimes. I thoroughly enjoyed your talk. I actually agree with many of the points that you're bringing up. But I have just some questions on some things that I thought. And one of the things you were saying was the government can never truly help. Like you were saying, the government can never make you an NBA player. That line like stuck with me, and of course that's true. A lot of things the government can't help with. But the question I wanted to ask was, regardless of what is causing a discrepancy in society, so many of the leftists believe it's some racial thing which you were debunking, but whatever it is, the two-parent or any aspect, there clearly is discrepancy in society, and a lot of it's unfair. And you may be right about this. You claim that the government is not the best tool that can help like, you know, bridge that gap.
Right.
But so my question basically comes down to when there's general, like you know, if there's people that like are not getting access to like food or water on a regular basis, or and another thing that I fundamentally believe everyone should have for free is access to as much education as they need. Because I personally think access to education is something that can prevent these kind of inequalities happening in society. So all sorts of things like, is there anything that anyone here believes everyone has a fundamental right to? What do you think is
so
the best?
My view of rights, just so you understand, my view of rights is that you don't have a right to anyone else's labor or services. So when you say you have a right to education, the problem with that is what you're really saying is I have a right to force a teacher to teach me. You don't have a right to do that, right? It's like when people say I have a right to health care, my wife's a doctor. You don't have a right to go to my wife and say to her, you will now care for me for free. I have a right to free speech because I don't have to impose anything on you to achieve that right. It's my right to be free from your oppression, right? I have a right to keep and bear arms because you don't have a right to take away my right to keep and bear arms. So this is the difference between what the left calls positive rights and what we call negative rights, right? Negative rights are just the idea that you have rights in the absence of government. These rights inhere in you personally, and you don't need anybody else in order for those rights to exist. The problem with it, so I agree that local communities particularly have an interest in education, right? The way that the founders foresaw this is there were public schools during the founding era, but they were all locally controlled. So the basic idea was the federal government has no place in any of this. You and your friends get together, like it's an HOA, like it's a condo HOA, and you all have a bunch of kids, and you decide to pool your resources and hire some teachers, and you have a local community school. The reason that's better is because, number one, you know the parents are invested in the kids. Number two, the parents have control over what's being taught to the kids, so it's more in line with their values. And number three, you don't have somebody who's far away telling you what should be taught to your kids. And local education has always been a better solution than federal education solutions. So I'm not talking that there can never be collective solutions to anything, but those collective solutions have to be incredibly well tailored, and the people who are engaged in the collective solution have to give their consent. So, for example, I think that it's unfair. If you're a single person and you've decided to live your entire life without having kids, I don't know why it's your job to educate my child. It's my job to educate my child. Right, parents have the original responsibility to educate. Now, if parents won't do that, that's where charity comes in. Right, that's why you need strong, vibrant social institutions to take over when you have people who are being harmed. Right, who can't take care of, really not people who are being, people who can't take care of themselves, is a better way to put it. Children, the disabled. You know, that's where you need strong social institutions to fill in that gap.
So if let's say in a certain particular society, there may not be enough. Look, you're basically saying then, even if there's not enough of these social institutions or enough good people or charitable people, because there's a lot of situations where kids are being brought up in maybe in these one-parent situations, maybe two-parent situations, but there's just not a good set of values in their house.
Right.
But they themselves, if they live in a society where the society thinks they don't have a right to someone else's labor, then how are these people going to have access to something?
Well, so when it comes to children, if the parents is not, one of the things that has happened is that social standards have fallen so low that parents in a lot of areas don't care about the education of their kids. That's child endangerment to it. I mean, if you don't care about the education of your kids, then honestly, that's a place where you're talking about criminal abuse of a child, right? And this is why you have truancy officers, right? So those are vulnerable people. But the solution has never been and can never be the government getting involved to the extent where they just pour money into an area and say, okay, here's some money, now it's solved. We pour money into inner city schools all the time, and it doesn't do anything because you're not changing the underlying effect. You're also not changing the fact that people are living in communities that have different value systems, and this is true for black and white. It's not specific to black communities. There are white rural communities that are like this too. The only way to overcome educational imbalances is, number one, to give parents more freedom of choice to move their kids around, and number two, to give more local control so that it's not the feds deciding. And number three, to actually have social institutions and social penalties for not governmental penalties, social penalties, social disapproval for people who are not doing what they ought to do for their kids. There should be guilt involved when you don't take care of your kid. And a lot of government activity is designed to relieve that guilt, right? I'm not feeding my kid, so the government will feed my kid. And I shouldn't feel guilty about it. The government's going to feed my kid. You should absolutely feel guilty and like a bad person if you're not feeding your kid.
Thank you very much.
I'm in my freshman year right now, and during the time I was seeing
have to deal with that. So, witnessing all that, it just seemed in the beginning worse and worse.
Yeah, it's gotten worse in the last couple of years,
for sure. So, what do you think, I came with my friends and said that, and our last meeting, we literally said, we don't even think the administration would allow us to get a speaker like you or Milo.
Well, they didn't. I want to thank the administration for that. So thank you to the administration for allowing that. But,
I'm talking about my campus.
Oh, your campus. Which campus are you?
St. Edward's.
St. Edward's. Okay.
But basically, since it does seem like it's getting worse, what do you think we should do about it?
Well, I think that, again, social guilt is a very powerful force. And DePaul is going to have to back off their ban. Right? I think that a lot of these universities, when they're exposed to the light of day, sunlight is a great disinfectant. So if you apply to have a speaker like me and your university refuses it, just get me the information and I'll have you on Fox News at night.
So Ben, I do consider myself a member of the left. But I do like
listening. Thanks for coming again.
I like listening to you, just like I like listening to Milo, whom I think you should debate at some point. I like listening to people from all over the spectrum, so I can have a better idea of where I stand, and so I can take information and be objective about it. I find myself agreeing with a lot of the things your friend Dave Rubin says, where you're as annoyed by the people who think everything is racist and everything is sexist as you are by people who, want to kick out immigrants. I think most people that I meet and speak to are somewhere in the middle where you don't want to fit yourself into any narrative. I think there are a lot of people like that, and I think society right now is in a place where everybody just wants to be extreme. You either want to assume that everybody's racist or nobody's.
Yeah, that's true.
Whereas I think they're not being honest with themselves. Do you think, in your honest opinion, there's a way we can, as a society, come forward and sort of bridge those people together?
Yes, I think most people, and this is actually coming back to the individual versus groupings. And when I say left and right, I'm using these as shorthand for political viewpoints, but I'm not talking about necessarily people, unless I cite a specific person who is of the left because this is their view. But the fact is that the only way that we're going to be able to come together is around certain instances of injustice. Individual justice is actually really a pretty simple thing for people to agree on. It's when you get to this stupid concept of social justice. Social justice is the opposite of individual justice, because justice doesn't need a modifier, right? Social justice is the idea that O.J. Simpson should have been let off because something bad happened with Rodney King, right? That's not individual justice, that's social justice. Social justice is the idea that your membership in an identity group means more than your responsibility for your own actions. When it comes down to individual responsibility, I think most people largely agree on what people should be responsible for on an individual level. And then when you see somebody do something bad, right and left, we all go, okay, well, that person ought to be punished. And when somebody does something good, I think we all, right and left, say that person ought to be rewarded. There should be a reward attached for that, and there usually is. The problem that I see is when all of that is obscured by an attempt at tribal identity. And you see this even on the right sometimes from the alt-right crowd, for example. I think that it's really negative when you allow group identity to overwhelm individual rights and individual scenarios. That's the bridge is going to be how we treat each other as individuals, which is why I always keep coming back to decency.
Thank you.
Hello, Ben. Nice to talk to you. It's like a real life mailbag. I have a question for you. Something I always struggle with understanding is the left's embrace of Islam. Because here you have in political Islam an ideology that is fundamentally opposed to so much what the left reports, yet you see the left increasingly promote on a scale of it happens in Europe with BBC News, it happens with our mainstream media with CNN, constantly putting out pro-Islam love pieces, etc. And I think this is related. The increasing criticism among particularly our cultural figures of Israel and growing anti-Israel sentiment. I've seen it on campus when people just try to voice appreciation for the country of Israel. There will be Marxists that come after them, the sort of...
there's a reason Bernie Sanders is very anti-Israel.
The Islamic organization is coming to protest as well, of course. What motivates this alliance?
So it all comes back to, all you have to remember about the left, really, when it comes down to it, is that fairness or not from idea. So what happens is, think about it from the perspective that that's your only priority. And you look at the world today, and what you see is that the wealthy countries are all Western European countries steeped in Judeo-Christian civilization. or at least raised in Judeo-Christian civilization, they've moved away from it. And then Islamic countries are dirt poor, right? The people there are in serious trouble. They have leadership that's absolutely awful. Authoritarian, brutal to women, brutal to homosexuals, just awful across the board. And what the left sees when they see that is not, why are those governments doing that to those poor people? Or why is this philosophy of radical Islam doing that to impoverished women and children? Like, why are they doing that? What the left instead sees is, hey, look, the rich person, the poor person, the rich person screwed the poor guy. Right? It was colonialism, it was imperialism, the West was colonialist and imperialist, they were too powerful. That's why these other countries are poor. Saudi Arabia is poor, even though it's not really. Saudi Arabia is poor because of the West. The Palestinians are poor because of Israel, right? It's always in opposition to something. It's never, maybe the Palestinians are poor because their leadership keeps stealing all their money and they keep voting for terrorists, right? Like, that would probably be a better explanation as to why they're consistently poor and engaging in terrorism. But instead of looking at the responsibility of the people who are actually making the decisions, they look to the global inequality. That's why they focus on things like the same drive that leads them to focus on income inequality as opposed to how do we make life better for poor people. Those are two separate questions, right? Income inequality is a stupid idea because who cares if one guy's rich and one guy's poor? I only care if the guy who's poor is poor. I'd like him to be richer, right? But the left sees a fixed pie in the world, and therefore, if one group is poor and one group is rich, the rich screw the poor. So there's a heroic poverty to the Islamic world that the left identifies with, and that overcomes all of their objections about the radicalism. In fact, they blame the radicalism on us, right? The radicalism isn't the fault of Islam or radical Islam. The radicalism is our fault for having victimized these poor Islamic people, and then they've been relegated to poverty and brutality because of us. That's why President Obama goes on an apology tour right after he's elected, because the idea is if you just relieve that notion that America is the big bad Satan, then everything will be all better, and if we redistribute resources, things will be all better. That's why the left identifies on a consistent basis with some of the worst people on earth.
Thank you.
Hey, I appreciate you coming. I appreciate hearing you speak, and I try not to subscribe to any ideology, and that's why I like listening to you, because I think you're actually going back to traditional conservatism instead of,
well, thank you.
You know what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. But, but what I wanted to ask is, America always, in the past century at least, always seems to search for some kind of opposition, whether it be Germany and then the Soviet Union, which is obvious and correct. But and then we meddled in South America, and then we did the former Yugoslavia. And then the most recent thing is, and the most recent proclamation is the war on terror. And I wanted your take. What do you think we should do moving forward with this?
With regard to the war on terror?
Yes.
I mean, look, the war on terror is a civilizational struggle against radical Islam. And failing to recognize that is our first mistake. Because if you pretend in a way, then that's not going to help. That being the case, you know, I think that you have to take each situation differently. So when it comes to global terror networks, obviously killing the leadership is the top priority. Then you have to talk about, and here I do think that Donald Trump, and this is actually Ted Cruz's plan originally, is correct when he says that you have to ensure that people who are coming into the country are not associated in any way with radicalism. You have to make sure that you've protected your own borders. And then you have to enable, you have to try and find good guys and enable them. That doesn't mean that you can intervene everywhere. That does mean that where you can intervene, and it's worthwhile in a cost-benefit analysis to do so, you should, but it's gonna be a long struggle. Is it something, the real question is it something we take seriously or not? If it's something we don't take seriously, then we can do sort of pinprick operations and pretend it's not a big deal. If it's something you take seriously, there are two possible solutions. One is the George W. Bush solution, which is you go in and you invade a country, and then you basically take it over for 30, 40 years, and you stay there until it's good, right? Which is a possibility. We did it to Japan, right? We did it to Germany. We did it for South Korea, essentially. You can do that. The other possibility is what Clement is a guy named Angelo Codafillo writes about this. He says the other possibility is that if the leadership of a country is enabling terrorism, you go in and you kill all of the leadership, you impose a Shah character. If that Shah falls, you go in and you kill the new leadership, you impose a new Shah character, and you just sort of do this cycle over and over. There are benefits and drawbacks to each of these possible solutions, but I don't think that the war on terror is even well named. Terror is a tactic. It is not a philosophy or an ideology. And as far as a global strategy to deal with it, it's it's a little bit too complex to answer with one sentence without bombing the shit out of them, as some people have suggested.
So you don't think, I'm sure that these two presidential candidates, which I don't think anyone really likes, they're not going to solve this, and that's why you're hoping for actual conservatives to...
Well, I mean, I don't think either of these two presidential candidates is solving anything. I mean, Hillary can't solve her way out of prison, and Donald Trump can't solve a simple multiplication table. The problem with terror, and this is just going to be a reality, is that it is a bit of playing whack-a-mole.
Yeah.
But most of it is going to, in the end, I do agree with the assessment that a lot of terrorism is funded by governments, and governments are the ones that are going to have to change if that terrorism is going to stop. And there have to be severe costs imposed for governments that fund terrorism, including the government of Iran.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here. In regards to the police shooting, and you did a good job of pointing out how the left misuses some of these stats. And then, and you cited some studies, specifically the one from the Harvard professor, Dr. Fryer. And I've read that study, and in that study he concludes that what it is is that we don't have enough evidence, and we don't have enough data. So do you ever worry that you might be misrepresenting the facts because we don't have all that data? And if so, like, how do you...
He did reach a conclusion based on the data set that he had. If the answer is that there are a bunch of racists who are hiding, you know, in the non-data, I can't prove a negative.
No, but that was right in certain cities, and even there, he doesn't know if those cities were willing to give him that data because they knew that they weren't targeting African Americans.
Right. So the question is, in the absence of data, this is a decent question. In the absence of data, should we assume racism or should we not assume racism?
Right. And how do you guard against you just assuming what you're already biased towards?
So you look at each individual situation in isolation and you determine whether the situation bears the marks of racism or whether it doesn't. And the problem is that people immediately leap to a conclusion. So, it actually does break down, unfortunately, along racial lines. Let's take an example, the shooting of Michael Brown in Missouri. When that happened, there were polls that came out in the week after. And what they showed was that the vast majority of white people didn't say that Michael, the officer, Darren Wilson, was innocent. What they actually said, by and large, was, we need more information. Which is actually the proper response, right? Let's wait till all the information comes out, then we'll make a call as to whether something racist happened here. Something like in excess of 80% of the black community immediately declared him guilty. Said Darren Wilson committed a racist shooting because we've heard the earlier reports and that's enough for us to make a judgment. I think that it is worthwhile in the absence of data to hold off judgment. The problem is that BLM doesn't even do that. They immediately assume any situation is evidence of not just an individual cop who's racist, but a systemic police bias. So if there's no evidence for systemic police bias, I can't assume that there is evidence of systemic police bias.
Yeah, you can't assume the opposite either.
Well, I can assume the absence of evidence. And in my view, before you call somebody racist, you better damn well have good evidence.
No, and I agree, but I just feel like on the other side, you might also be doing the thing on the other side where you're saying, hey, well, they're just completely wrong.
Well, based on the current data, they are completely wrong. When they present data that conflicts with that, then I'm happy to reconsider my position.
Okay.
I'm not going to do it based on anecdotal evidence or my story about how I feel as a black person in America, because we all have stories where we feel bad. I'm sure black people have a lot of stories where they feel really bad about run-ins with law enforcement, but there's no way for anybody to check anybody's anecdotal work.
No, I agree, but do you agree that nationwide, so we can't...
Well, I mean, I'm definitely up for better data. I'd love if they would collect better data. The data that I see right now does not bear any resemblance to the case BLM was made.
Would you change your opinion if the data came out?
Yeah, I mean, of course. I mean, and new evidence bears changed opinions, that's all.
All right, so first of all, I think you'd like completely destroy my line of debate. Second of all, all right, so how do you think that we could actually solve the problem with black communities? Because people I was actually at the affirmative action, protest last week, and I started to argue with a bunch of people, and they never actually proposed a solution that helps black people, or black communities at home. What they said was, hey, send them to college, and that will help them. And how do you think that?
When we talk about, you know, the problem in black communities, I think that we have to be a little bit more specific, because there are lots of problems in lots of communities, and there are lots of problems in black communities that are not specific to black people. Again, the single motherhood rate in the white community was 5% in 1960. Today, it's well in excess of 40%. That's a problem in the white community. Right? I don't think it has anything to do with race. I think it has a lot to do with pathologies of culture that are negative, whether you're talking hillbilly elegy in J.D. Vance's book in Kentucky, or whether you're talking about, you know, the black community in South Central Los Angeles. So that said, the solutions aren't the same for everybody, right? And this is sort of the purpose of the speech. The solutions aren't the same for everybody. Don't have babies out of wedlock, go to school, get a job. The problem with affirmative action is it actually effectively does not allow people who benefit from affirmative action to go to schools where they can succeed. The dropout rate is significantly higher for affirmative action students. You're penalizing people based on their race, because the fact is that Colin Powell's kid benefits from affirmative action, but, you know, some poor schlub living in West Virginia who grows up really poor, that and his wife, that guy, you know, is being pushed out for Colin Powell's kid. You can't do it on the basis of color. And beyond that, if you actually want to create workable solutions, then hard work is the only way to do that. Now, one of the problems that we have in the United States now is that because we have so much information at our fingertips about how everybody else is doing in life, we all expect to rise to become Bill Gates in one generation. That's not how wealth works. The reality is that for pretty much everybody in this room, your grandparents were probably poorer than you are. And that's been true throughout human history. And when people grow up poor and then immediately want to be making and start in a worse situation than someone else, the immediate idea is something unfair has happened. Well, something unfair has happened, but that's not correctable by government. In the end, the keys to solving things in high crime black areas, for example, is you need more cops to police the crime and get the criminals out of the community. You need parents who are going to do a better job of focusing on making sure that their kids have a solid education. That means stop incentivizing single motherhood on the state and federal governmental level. And it also means that I think part of this is solved by the crime problem, there are not enough jobs in those communities, because who wants to locate their business in a place where there's a riot every few years, right? If you want to locate your business where it's safe, you're not going to get broken into. Putting cops in a high crime community is a great way of ensuring that businesses move in, providing jobs and economic growth, and that will actually create the tax revenue necessary to generate a decent public school system. So all of these things are solvable, but they start with individual decent behavior and the government actually doing what the government is supposed to do, which is stop people from violating other people's rights. If you do those two things, decent behavior, have the government stop people from violating people's rights, that's the basis for all success regardless of the community.
Is one more question okay?
Yeah, it's quick.
All right, yeah, it's pretty quick. All right, so you know how, I guess we're in grade school, and high school, we're told like an ideal version of history. And then in college, we get the more graphic version. Do you think that actually affects the way that people actually start to hate white people after a long time? Because on this campus...
Well, I mean, what anybody learns about history is going to bias things. There are a lot of Jews who still won't buy German cars because of the Holocaust. Right, okay, well, it's 7 years later, it's okay to buy a German car. Right, the Germans who are alive now are not the Germans who were murdering your great-grandparents. The way that the focus on historic wrongs to the exclusion of the perfection of the American ideal is the problem on college campuses. If you are taught that the American ideal was founded, this is the basic differences in the view of history. So the sort of traditional view of American history is that America was founded with brilliant ideas that America did not live up to. And America has been a process of moving toward the realization of those ideas. In some ways, we've moved very much toward it with regard to the treatment of black people, the treatment of women, the treatment of gay people. In some ways, we've moved tremendously against it in terms of the growth of government. But the idea is that the ideals that the founders spelled out are the correct ones. Then there's the idea of the left, which is that those ideals are just a reflection of racism, sexism, bigotry, and homophobia. If that's your idea of American history, America is a country founded in sin, and the only way to overcome that sin is to disown the founding itself and overthrow the governmental ideological structure. And that's why you hate every aspect of American history. You have to read it all in the worst possible light, because it comes from a bad place.
I think you.
Hey, been a big fan here, read a lot of your stuff. But
thank you.
I've noticed that you're, you know, for Citizens United, you don't want to do any restrictions on campaign contributions.
Yes.
You know, and that's an argument I totally agree with, but in light of all the information that's come out of, you know, the Democrats selling ambassadorships to the highest bidder, you know, using that to turn quid pro quo, you know, would you want to put any sort of limitations on giving campaign contributions in instances where you can actually prove it was for something? Or
well, I mean, if there's quid pro quo, I think there should be legal limitations. I don't think you should be paying the government to do things for you. That's pretty corrupt. I mean, unfortunately, it's been the habit of the U.S. government really since inception that rich people who donate lots of money get to be ambassador to Fiji, and then the unlucky guy gets to be the ambassador to Afghanistan. Corruption in government is endemic to a business where there's lots of money involved in the government itself. Not the amount of government that goes into election. Here's the truth. If government were small and did not matter to you, you would not be contributing money to political figures because they wouldn't be bothering you. Right? I don't contribute money to the Texas state government, right? I don't get involved in Texas state races, really, because I don't live in Texas. You do. Presumably, you don't get involved in California state races because the people in California don't bother you, so what do you care? Right? If Washington didn't bother you, right? If Washington were small and didn't bother you, as former Governor Perry liked to say, if Washington, D.C. were insignificant in your life, nobody would be paying money to be involved with government. The reason that you have so much corruption is not because of the people who are attempting to corrupt government, but because government is just a giant corrupt cash bag, and if you get control of those levers, then you can steal some of that money for yourself. That's the problem. The problem is the size of government, not the size of the contributions. Because again, if government didn't do anything, no one would be contributing money to get hold of it. If government were worthless, who wants a piece of it?
Thank you.
Okay. On your podcast, you talked about how the left is obsessed with backstory. I was kind of hoping you can speak to that. And my other question, I guess, well, my other point, I guess, is in your podcast as well, you've talked about the dangers of a subjective definition for freedom, which I think is, I mean, that was like, you talked about the book that it came from, like by Stephen James or something. Liberty,
Equality. James Fitzgerald Stephen?
Yeah.
Could you talk about the Liberty, Equality, Fraternity? One of the great kind of ignored quotes of the last 10 years in the United States, it's really an egregious quote. It's from President Obama's second inaugural, where he said, everybody in America, we don't even have to have the same definition of freedom. No, that's pretty much the one thing we do have to have the same definition. If your definition of freedom is stealing my crap, we've got a problem. What I say about liberty is when people say I believe in American exceptionalism, I want a definition of what you mean by that. When people say I believe in freedom, I want to know, what do you mean by freedom? When you say I believe, when people say, Barack Obama wants what's best for the country, that doesn't mean anything to me. When they say he's a patriot because he wants what's best for the country, yeah, but what if his definition of what's best for the country is the opposite of mine? I don't care that he wants what's best for the country. I assume that they're not the same. These have nothing to do with one another. But I assume that in his own way, Bin Laden wanted what was best for the United States. He wanted it to be an Islamic Sharia law state, right? But that's not something I agree with and make him an American patriot. The patriotism to me is the idea that you stand up and believe in the founding ideals of the country. And those are expressed in the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution. As far as the backstory question, I was talking about particularly kind of fiction and narrative. On the podcast at one point, and I was saying that the left feels the need to give every character a backstory. Backstory is the whole thing. And that, to me, is it's true in life also. Democrats and the leftists are very obsessed with the idea that every time somebody does something bad, we have to delve into their past and figure out why they did the bad thing. Right? We always have to ask why. Okay, well, why is an important question, but a significantly more important question is what did they just do, and what is the punishment they should bear for that? The left mistakes sympathy for change of policy. Right? If you have sympathy for someone because they had a rough childhood, now we have to change the policy with regard to that person, and that's something I just don't buy.
Thank you.
Hi, Ben. The left has a strangle grip on the entertainment industry.
Yeah.
And since you authored Primetime Propaganda, I wondered if you had a perspective on how conservatives take it back.
Okay, well, this is actually another tough one. So conservatives tend to be like dolphins with regards to the entertainment industry. Dolphins sleep with half their brain on and half their brain off. So conservatives have a political side of our brain and we have an entertainment side of our brain. When we are political, then we are super political. And when we are entertainment oriented, then we don't want to hear anything about politics. So that means that when people come and they say, okay, we need to make entertainment product, we need to make conservative movies or movies that reflect conservative values, conservatives don't know which side of the brain to put it in. Because if they put it in their political side of the brain, they go, I don't like entertainment, the only movies I watch are Ronald Reagan biopics. and then at the end of the day, they go home and they watch Modern Family, just like everybody else in the United States. And they don't understand that for the left, there's no two sides of the brain, it's all the same. And so what the right needs to understand is that if they would stop sinking tens of millions of dollars into useless politicians, and start sinking tens of millions of dollars into producing mass entertainment that young people watch, that would actually have more of an impact than you giving $1 million to a politician who's going to lose by 5%. It's just, that money can be better used. I say this all the time to donors. Like, well, what is your expected return? Do you have any expected return on your political donations? And they say, well, the expected return is that we're going to win. And it's like, well, yeah, but probably not. So now what are we going to do with that money? So a better investment to me would be start taking some of that money and pouring it into the talented people in Hollywood who want to push things that are not explicitly political, but that reflect basic values that are conservative.
Thank you for coming. You stated that one of the, you know, the big idea, instead of, you know, white privilege, is decision-making privilege.
Yes.
And a lot of communities, especially disadvantaged communities and single-parent households, a lot of the youth are, they don't have the morals taught to them, the lessons taught to them in order to make well-informed decisions. Mm-hmm. You kind of touched on that in saying, you know, we need to have parents who are decent people. Well, how do we actually bring that about? How do we have parents and society as a whole become more decent people?
So the first thing is you actually have to get rid of the safety net for bad decisions. So one of the things that has happened is with the advent of the welfare state, before the advent of the welfare state, the single motherhood rate in the black community in 1960 was 20%. Today, 70% of black kids are born out of wedlock, which is an insane number. And it's rising in every community. And that's largely because people feel like, if I can get away with a bad decision and somebody's going to pay me for the bad decision, why wouldn't I make the bad decision? You have to disincentivize the bad decision. And there has to be a renewal of the social stigma attached. And this is what the entertainment industry has done that's so wrong, is when they say every family is the same, every family is equal in quality. No, every family is not the same or equal in quality. It's just not true. We all know it from people that we know. And that's even true among parents in, you know, two parent households, right? But on a generalized level, it's certainly true when you talk about two parents versus one parent households. There are individual one parent households that can be wonderful, and individual two parent households that can be crap. But on a general level, it is better to have a two parent household than to have a one parent household. The entertainment industry has really sinned in this capacity and taught people an absolute falsehood about raising kids. So that's where, you know, we're going to have to fight back on that front. I think the churches are going to have to fight back. Churches have put an enormous amount of stock in not making people feel bad about themselves. You should feel inspired when you leave church. You shouldn't feel bad if you make a bad decision. I mean, religion was, the draw of religion is also the idea that when you do something, that you bear the consequences of that, and there is such a thing as right and wrong. Eternal values are based on eternal right and wrong. So, you know, it's about time that the preachers start telling their flock, particularly teenagers, that if you have a kid and abandon that kid, you're doing something wrong. And if you have sex out of wedlock, thinking the guy's gonna marry you, think again, because the truth is that is extraordinarily, unfortunately in today's America, that's extraordinarily rare. The social institutions have completely collapsed, and government has tried to use a substitute, you can't use the government as a substitute. So it's a long haul. I mean, this is not a quick fix. But one of the things that's gonna happen is people are gonna have to start telling the truth about these things, even if it offends folks. I get so much blowback. I spoke at a high school in Otay Ranch, which is like San Diego, a very low-income high school. This is probably a year and a half ago. And I said all the things I'm saying right now about to a bunch of poor kids, what you can do to escape poverty. Do these things, and you won't live in permanent poverty. And the principal actually came down and stopped the speech in the middle to excuse the students, because he was afraid too many students were being offended by me saying that you shouldn't have kids out of wedlock, and they should make good decisions with your money. I said, but that's exactly what they need to hear. They don't need to hear that their parents made great decisions if they're living in poverty. You need to learn when you're, like, part of being an adult is recognizing that your parents aren't perfect and trying to correct the mistakes that you see your parents make. And if we all have a stake in not hurting feelings, it's going to be very difficult to make society a better place for anybody.
Thank you.
Hi. I feel like the way you're talking about, like, societal policing of transgender bodies, like, violates the, you know, the principle of, like, conservatism and, like, just meeting people alone. So I guess microaggressions aside, because I don't really subscribe to that term either, why do you care so much about the way somebody chooses to identify?
I don't care at all. I do care about what they force me to say about it.
Okay.
That's the answer. If you want to go ahead and do that, if you want to, you know, have surgery on yourself, I could not care less. If you want to dress how you want to dress, I really don't care. But if the idea is that I'm supposed to now blind myself to reality and pretend, you know, in front of my children that a man is a woman or a woman is a man, or that it is healthy for a man who thinks he's a woman to get a surgery, that I'm not willing to do. You're demanding something of me. I'm not demanding anything of you if you're a transgender person, but you're demanding something of me if you expect me to change my view of reality based on your subjective view of yourself.
So if your view of reality changes due to, I guess, could it ever change due to new scientific evidence supporting?
I'd be hard pressed to find. When it comes to transgenderism, I don't see any evidence that a man can magically become a woman. It just doesn't work that way. There are people who are intersex, and that they're intersex. I mean, that's science. They're intersex, right? And they're what you say. There's nothing else to say. That's a fact. Okay, but it is propagating a fiction to suggest that Caitlyn Jenner can become a woman. Caitlyn Jenner can never become a woman. Okay, I watched my wife give birth twice. Caitlyn Jenner will never do that. Caitlyn Jenner is not a woman. Okay, Caitlyn Jenner is not capable of being a woman. Caitlyn Jenner is a man he's living in a really difficult situation. I feel terrible for him. But that does not mean that I'm going to tell lies to children about whether you can identify as a member of the opposite sex. And number one, live a happier life, because that is just, the depression and suicide rates in the transgender community are absolutely astronomical. And the percentage of kids who say that they're transgender when they're kids and then grow out of it as they get older is extremely high. 8 in 10 kids who say that they have transgender feelings when they're kids do not consider themselves transgender when they get older. Some consider themselves gay and lesbian, but the vast majority of them don't stick with this. So the new civil rights push to say a four-year-old should be able to get hormone treatment because your four-year-old son thinks he's your four-year-old daughter, that's a devastating evil that you're perpetrating on a child who has no capacity to make those decisions.
So familiar with yourself as I am with Milo. I listen to Milo a lot more. But I know that you guys don't listen.
Well, he's got a charming British accent.
Yeah. Like, from what I heard today, you sound amazing. And I'm really thankful to have come and listened to you. But I know you guys don't get along. And I know that Milo more represents what is known as the alt-right, or supposedly
yes.
Represents what is, he's more so...
He sort of denies it half the time, he embraces it half the time. Yeah. Because it's provocateur, not...
And you know as well as I that Hillary Clinton declared war on Pepe the Frog and all this stuff.
Yes.
So, given that there's the traditional GOP, neocons and all those guys, and then who were supposed to be the quote-unquote revolutionaries or different people, the Tea Party, and now we have the alt-right, what do you think is going to happen to the Republican Party, and what do you think should happen to the Republican Party?
Okay, so there's so many strains of what they call the establishment. So first we have to define terms, because everybody mixes this up, right? People have said that when Ted Cruz wouldn't endorse Trump, suddenly he was establishment. That's a bunch of crap, right? He was calling Mitch McConnell a liar on the floor of the Senate. The fact is that, I'll give you my definitions of these various groups, and then I'll tell you how they interact. Okay, so there's the neocons, technically speaking, are people who used to be liberal and in the 1960s and 70s shifted to the right. So that means that they are relatively warm toward the welfare state, but that they are very interventionist and hawkish on foreign policy, along the lines of Ronald Reagan on foreign policy. Right? That's sort of the old Urban Crystal at Commentary magazine. Then you have the people who are kind of hardcore constitutionalist conservatives. That's where I consider myself. I think it's like where Mark Levin is, probably where Ted Cruz is. And we're hawkish on foreign policy, but we're realists as opposed to we're going to go in and try and take over countries and this sort of thing. We don't think that democracy can be implanted in foreign soil without an enormous amount of time and effort. And we believe that constitutional limitations on government are the proper way of ensuring freedom. That's another wing of the Republican Party. There's the sort of blue dog Democrat side of the Republican Party. Which is people who believe in bigger government but are not quite Democrats on the social side, and then there's the alt-right. So the alt-right is it's not 100% crossover, but it's kind of close. The alt-right basically believes what Pappy Cannon believes. They're isolationists on foreign policy. They believe that cultural autonomy can only be protected by protecting us ethnically. This is why the alt-right is the alt-right. So people consider themselves alt-right because they think they're doing memes. Okay, that doesn't make you alt-right. Okay, I think memes are hilarious also. But alt-right, if you read the founders of the alt-right movement, if you read people like Vox Day, who's alt-right, if you read people like Richard Spencer, who's alt-right, if you read the actual people who created the alt-right, what they will say, and Milo says it in his piece about the alt-right, if Breitbart has made so much noise, in that piece he says, these are folks who believe that race and culture are indistinct. That they are inherently connected. I think that's evil. I actually think that's evil. I don't think that race and culture are connected. I don't think that just because you're black, we can assume that you are incapable of imbibing Western civilization, or if you cross the southern border, you're incapable of imbibing Western civilization. I believe that we have to check their ideology at the door, but I don't believe that ethnicity and culture are linked. The alt-right does. And what I think Milo has done, and it's been really a problem, it's why I oppose so much of what Milo does. We agree on some things, we really disagree on this. And I think that he's done some really terrible things because of this. He has broadened the definition of alt-right to try and suck people into warmth toward these ideas under the guise of, it's all just frivolous joviality. Okay, a lot of it isn't. Okay, the roots of the alt-right movement are really egregiously bad. And also, I have to say that Milo's take on political correctness is quite stupid. His take on political correctness is that political correctness should be fought by simply breaking every taboo. This is Milo's perspective, right? And so that's why he thinks it's mischievous and trolly when you send people gas chamber names, right? And listen, I've gotten a lot of it this last year. Okay, the Anti-Defamation League labeled me the number one recipient of journalistic anti-Semitism in the United States this year. There are 20,000 anti-Semitic tweets sent between March and September. I was the personal recipient of 8,000 of them. Okay, and I've received literally dozens of death threats. I've gotten threats on my phone. You know, all of this is coming from the mischievous trolley people who Milo likes to incentivize. And Milo's not responsible for bad people doing bad things, but he is responsible for giving them a feeling of community and a feeling of and mainstreaming them. That's what I object to. What political correctness is bad, why it's bad, is because it forbids us from saying true things that need to be said in order to make society a better place. Right? So, for example, I think it's politically incorrect for me to talk so much about single motherhood. It's politically incorrect. People get offended. That's useful, because people have to say it. It is not politically incorrect for Donald Trump to say, grab him by the booty. Right? Donald Trump defines that as politically incorrect because it's something people don't say. But things people don't say and politically correct are not the same thing. Right? Sometimes you're just being an asshole. So the problem that I see with Milo's perspective on this is that if you're just being a teenage jackass, that does not mean that you're pushing the ball forward in any real substantive way toward making the world a better place. Like, I'm glad people enjoy peppy memes, but I'm not sure how the peppy memes have really changed things in any real way. Like, Gamergate changed things in a real way because you're attempting to fight back against the left's dominance of feminism in video games and their attempts to destroy the video gaming industry. But that's a real thing. But just sending random tweets about cucks to people seems really stupid to me. It seems like a waste of time. So that's why I think that's where my big difference with Milo lies. He keeps saying we need a new conservatism, and he still has yet to define his new conservatism other than this sort of ethnocentric nationalism that he says he doesn't preach. But it's not the Constitution. He says that's washed up. Okay, if Constitution and limited governments are washed up, then I don't know what your conservatism is. You say you want to preserve Western civilization. Which principles do you like, and how are those preserved without a limited government philosophy other than by ethnic solidarity that is in direct opposition to the ideas of a universal Western civilization?
Thank you.
That's actually time for questions. By all means, why not? Another round of applause. They've been also a huge, huge help for our event today. The Department of Students. We've had tremendous help from the Dean of Students Office, and we have two people out here, so if there are also, we had a lot of help from the Events and Entertainment Board, co-sponsorship board for this event, so another round of applause for them. Also, we have to thank Young Americas Foundation. They helped us tremendously for this event, not only helped us with logistics, but also helped us fund Mr. Shapiro coming to UT Austin. So a huge round of applause to them.
For more information on Young America's Foundation, Google them, if I'm not mistaken, it's yaf.org. They have outstanding information there. You can also kind of stalk Mr. Shapiro. All his links are on there, you know, you can find him. If you want to go to another one of his speeches, or if you want to find another great speaker that they're hosting, that would be the website for you to go to. Also, I would like to thank, just because now I can thank who helped me, thank all of my YCT officers, and if y'all would stand. They help me, they are the background. And as I said earlier, the Young Conservatives of Texas aren't here to, you know, cause riots. We're not here to be the bad people on campus. We're just here to cultivate discussion and also help you cultivate your political beliefs. If, as I mean, in our encounters, many freshmen, you know, they don't know quite enough about, or quite much about politics and stuff of that nature. So we're here to kind of provide the right side, right ideology, versus, you know, you can go to class and get the left. If y'all are interested at all in the Young Conservatives of Texas here at UT Austin, you guys are good at this. Facebook us. You all know where to find us. If you see any of the officers or see myself on campus, don't hesitate. Like, literally pull us aside and say, hey, I want to be a member. We offer a lot of great opportunities for our members. If you're looking to get into politics, looking at getting into lobbying, if you just want to have a really, really cool group of friends that you don't have to, you know, filter your speech with, we're a great organization for that. Also, I would like to thank all our Young Conservative Texas chapter from Texas State for coming, as well as everyone else that came from various other chapters. So now we have a couple people from Tech here, St. Edward's, A&M, local people from Texas State, and as always, thank you for all the Longhorns that came out today. Now we have the reception, which is all four YCT members. If you have a wristband, you are a VIP member for the reception. Right now, everyone that is not here, if you all would please exit through the back doors, like call me, and then if you have a wristband, stay put, and then we'll probably call you.
Sorry, what is
the objectivity of morality?
Yeah, and I agree. I think there's a serious values difference that has broken out in this country since the 1960s. And that can't be obscured, and it can't be glossed over with friendly words about how we all want the same thing. We don't all want the same thing. This is why I'm very harsh on the, I say it's a nasty, evil concept, this idea of the government imposing fairness of outcome on people, or that it's the job of the collective to do that in violation of individual rights. The thing is, I think most people, down deep, and if I didn't believe this, then I wouldn't think there's a future to politics. I do think that down deep, most people understand that individual rights need to trump the collective desire to harm your individual rights for the gain of the collective. If people didn't believe that, then there really wouldn't be hope for the country. But people don't even have it presented in those ways. One of the things that bothers me about how people on the right present political arguments is they're constantly talking about what politics works and what works and what doesn't. It's kind of the Paul Ryan approach to politics, right? If we do entitlement reform, this many people will be saved on Social Security. If we don't, this many people won't. And that to me is almost, it's a secondary argument. You first have to discuss what is the role of government in people's lives. You first have to discuss what is right and wrong. And we have to reteach that from the most basic level. And so that's going to start with teaching our kids, our own kids, at the most basic level. I have two. I have one that's 2.5 and one that's 6 months. And it's going to start with me teaching them at the most basic level. But it's also going to be challenging the left's feeling of unearned moral superiority. People on the left feel, the things they say are very stupid sometimes, but they feel good about what they're saying. And that's the only thing that matters. Like Bernie Sanders acolytes, it never occurs to them that they're stealing other people's money, that you are voting to literally take somebody else's labor and time from them. Right? They say, oh no, I'm fair, I'm making a better person because I'm willing to give up. Well, no, you're not willing to give up. If you're willing to give up, you just give charity. You're willing for me to give up by taking the government gun, pointing it at my head, and saying, me and my friends vote for you, give me your money. Right? You don't get to do that. That makes you an ass. And the fact is that if we don't argue in those terms and force people on the left to confront the roots of their own morality, you're never going to come to the point where we can even have an argument about values. The part of the thing that just annoys me about values, about political discussion, is politics is like an iceberg, and everybody's always discussing the tip of the iceberg, and 90% of the iceberg is underwater. We need to be discussing the stuff that's underwater. Sorry, I have your...
Really, what the point was, sorry, was discussing what that root is, and that's why I'm kind of bringing up the belief, or really just the general concept of God in someone's life.
Well, no, listen, if the Yama comes in to indicate it, I'm a very religious person. So I believe deeply in the basis of Judeo-Christian morality, and that's why on a social level, not on a governmental level, government has no business in this. A free government can only exist when people are moral, right? Everybody from Tocqueville to today, Adam says that. And so you're going to need churches and synagogues to do a better job of inculcating values in the kids they teach, as opposed to, here's some guitar music and pizza, come to church on Sundays. It's a waste of time, it doesn't teach anybody anything, and they do it at synagogues too, so it's not unique to Christians. It's ripped the heart out of religion and made it meaningless. And unless religion can regain its footing as a moral arbiter and a speaker for eternal values, then why would anybody waste their Sunday going to church for pizza and guitar when you can stay home and have pizza and not listen to a preacher? Seems a lot better to me, right? I pray three times a day. If I didn't believe there were eternal values behind that, I would certainly not waste my time doing that.
Hi, so I'm someone, my name's Sai, and I swing towards the left is a little bit something, but I thoroughly
enjoyed. Thank you for coming, I appreciate what
you're doing. Yeah, I thoroughly enjoyed your talk. I actually agree with many of the points that you're bringing up, but I have just some questions on some things that I thought. And one of the things you were saying was the government can never truly help. Like you were saying, the government can never make you an NBA player. That line like stuck with me. Mm-hmm. And of course, that's true. A lot of things the government can't help with. But the question I wanted to ask was, regardless of what is causing a discrepancy in society, so many of the leftists believe it's some racial thing which you were debunking, but
right.
Whatever it is, the two-parent or mm-hmm. any aspect, there clearly is discrepancy in society, and a lot of it's unfair. And you may be right about this, you claim that the government is not the best tool that can help, like, you know, bridge that gap.
Right.
But so my question basically comes down to when there's general, like you know, if there's people that, like, are not getting access to, like, food or water on a regular basis. Or mm-hmm. And another thing that I fundamentally believe everyone should have for free is access to as much education as they need. Because I mm-hmm. personally think access to education is something that can prevent these kind of inequalities happening in society. So all sorts of things like, is there anything that anyone here believes everyone has a fundamental right to? What do you think is the best?
My view of rights, just so you understand, my view of rights is that you don't have a right to anyone else's labor or services. So when you say you have a right to education, the problem with that is what you're really saying is I have a right to force a teacher to teach me. You don't have a right to do that, right? It's like when people say I have a right to health care, my wife's a doctor. You don't have a right to go to my wife and say to her, you will now care for me for free. And I have a right to free speech because I don't have to impose anything on you to achieve that right. It's my right to be free from your oppression, right? I have a right to keep and bear arms because you don't have a right to take away my right to keep and bear arms. So this is the difference between what the left calls positive rights and what we call negative rights, right? Negative rights are just the idea that you have rights in the absence of government. These rights inhere in you personally, and you don't need anybody else in order for those rights to exist.
Back to traditional conservatism instead of,
well, thank you.
You know what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. But what I wanted to ask is, America always, in the past century at least, always seems to search for some kind of opposition, whether it be Germany and then the Soviet Union, which is obvious and correct. But and then we meddled in South America, and then we did the former Yugoslavia. And then the most recent thing is, in the most recent proclamation, is the war on terror. And I wanted your take. What do you think we should do moving forward with this?
Well, with regard to the war on terror?
Yes.
I mean, look, the war on terror is a civilizational struggle against radical Islam. And failing to recognize that is our first mistake. Because if you pretend in a way, then that's not going to help. That being the case, you know, I think that you have to take each situation differently. So when it comes to global terror networks, obviously killing the leadership is the top priority. Then you have to talk about, and here I do think that Donald Trump, and this is actually Ted Cruz's plan originally, is correct when he says that you have to ensure that people who are coming into the country are not associated in any way with radicalism. You have to make sure that you've protected your own borders. And then you have to try and find the good guys and enable them. That doesn't mean that you can intervene everywhere. That does mean that where you can intervene, and it's worthwhile in a cost-benefit analysis to do so, you should, but it's going to be a long struggle. Is it something the real question is it something we take seriously or not? If it's something we don't take seriously, then we can do sort of pinprick operations and pretend it's not a big deal. If it's something you take seriously, there are two possible solutions. One is the George W. Bush solution, which is you go in and you invade a country, and then you basically take it over for 30, 40 years, and you stay there until it's good, right? Which is a possibility. We did it to Japan, right? We did it to Germany. We did it for South Korea, essentially. you can do that. The other possibility is what Claremont is, this guy named Angelo Cotofia writes about this. He says the other possibility is that if the leadership of a country is enabling terrorism, you go in, you kill all of the leadership, you impose a Shah character. If that Shah falls, you go in and you kill the new leadership, you impose a new Shah character, and you just sort of do this cycle over and over. There are benefits and drawbacks to each of these possible solutions, but I don't think that the war on terror is even well named. Terror is a tactic. It is not a philosophy or an ideology. And as far as a global strategy to deal with it, it's a little bit too complex to answer with one sentence about bombing the shit out of them, as some people have suggested.
So you don't think, and I'm sure that these two presidential candidates, which I don't think anyone really likes, they're not going to solve this, and that's why you're hoping for actual conservatives to...
Well, I mean, I don't think either of these two presidential candidates is solving anything. I mean,
yeah.
Hillary can't solve her way out of prison, and Donald Trump can't solve a simple multiplication table.
Yeah.
The problem with terror, and this is just going to be a reality, is that it is a bit of plan whack-a-mole.
Yeah.
But most of it is going to, in the end, I do agree with the assessment that a lot of terrorism is funded by governments, and governments are the ones that are going to have to change if that terrorism is going to stop. And there have to be severe costs imposed for governments that fund terrorism, including the government of Iran.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here. In regards to the police shooting, and you did a good job of pointing out how the left misuses some of these stats. And then, and you cited some studies, specifically the one from the Harvard professor, Dr. Fryer. And I've read that study, and in that study he concludes that we don't have enough evidence and we don't have enough data. So do you ever worry that you might be misrepresenting the facts because we don't have all that data? And if so, like, how do you...
Well, he did reach a conclusion based on the data set that he had. If the answer is that there are a bunch of racists who are hiding, you know, in the non-data, I can't prove a negative.
No, but that was
right
in certain cities. And even there, he doesn't know if those cities were willing to give him that data because they knew that they weren't targeting African Americans.
Right. So the question is, in the absence of data, this is a decent question. In the absence of data, should we assume racism or should we not assume racism?
Right. And how do you guard against you just assuming what you're already biased towards?
So you look at each individual situation in isolation and you determine whether the situation bears the marks of racism or whether it doesn't. And the problem is that people immediately leap to a conclusion. So, it actually does break down, unfortunately, along racial lines. Let's take an example, the shooting of Michael Brown in Missouri. Well, when that happened, there were polls that came out in the week after, and what they showed was that the vast majority of white people didn't say that the officer, Darren Wilson, was innocent. What they actually said, by and large, was, we need more information, which is actually the proper response, right? Let's wait till all the information comes out, then we'll make a call as to whether something racist happened here. Something like in excess of 80% of the black community immediately declared him guilty. Said Darren Wilson committed a racist shooting because we've heard the earlier reports and that's enough for us to make a judgment. I think that it is worthwhile in the absence of data to hold off judgments. The problem is that BLM doesn't even do that. They immediately assume any situation is evidence of not just an individual cop who's racist, but a systemic police bias. So if there's no evidence, the problem with it, so I agree that local communities particularly have an interest in education. Right? The way that the founders foresaw this is there were public schools during the founding era, but they were all locally controlled. So the basic idea was the federal government has no place in any of this. You and your friends get together, like it's an HOA, like it's a condo HOA, and you all have a bunch of kids, and you decide to pool your resources and hire some teachers, and you have a local community school. The reason that's better is because, number one, you know the parents are invested in the kids. Number two, the parents have control over what's being taught to the kids, so it's more in line with their values. And number three, you don't have somebody who's far away telling you what should be taught to your kids. And local education has always been a better solution than federal education solutions. So I'm not talking that there can never be collective solutions to anything, but those collective solutions have to be incredibly well tailored, and the people who are engaged in the collective solution have to give their consent. So for example, I think that it's unfair. If you're a single person and you've decided to live your entire life without having kids, I don't know why it's your job to educate my child. It's my job to educate my child. Right? Parents have the original responsibility to educate. Now, if parents won't do that, that's where charity comes in. Right? That's why you need strong, vibrant social institutions to take over when you have people who are being harmed. right, who can't take care of, really not people who are baby, people who can't take care of themselves, a better way to put it, children, the disabled. You know, that's where you need strong social institutions to fill in that gap.
But so if there, if like there's, let's say in a certain particular society, there may not be enough, look, you're basically saying then, even if there's not enough of these social institutions or enough good people or charitable people, because there's a lot of situations where kids are being brought up in maybe in these one parent situations, mm-hmm. maybe two parent situations, but there's just not a good set of values in their house.
Right.
But they themselves, if they live in a society where the society thinks they don't have a right to someone else's labor, then how are these people going to have access to something?
Well, so when it comes to children, if the parents is not, one of the things that has happened is that social standards have fallen so low that parents in a lot of areas don't care about the education of their kids. That's child endangerment to me. I mean, if you don't care about the education of your kids, then honestly, that's a place where you're talking about criminal abuse of a child, right? And this is why you have truancy officers, right? So those are vulnerable people. But the solution has never been and can never be the government getting involved to the extent where they just pour money into an area and say, okay, here's some money, now it's solved. We pour money into inner city schools all the time, and it doesn't do anything because you're not changing the underlying effect. You're also not changing the fact that people are living in communities that have different value systems, and this is true for black and white. It's not specific to black communities. There are white rural communities that are like this too. The only way to overcome educational imbalances is, number one, to give parents more freedom of choice to move their kids around, and number two, to give more local control so that it's not the feds deciding, and number three, to actually have social institutions and social penalties for not governmental penalties, social penalties, social disapproval for people who are not doing what they ought to do for their kids. There should be guilt involved when you don't take care of your kid. And a lot of government activity is designed to relieve that guilt, right? I'm not feeding my kid, so the government will feed my kid. And I shouldn't feel guilty about it. The government's going to feed my kid. You should absolutely feel guilty and like a bad person if you're not feeding your kid.
Thank you very much.
Well, I mean, I think that, again, social guilt is a very powerful force. And DePaul is going to have to back off their ban, right? I mean, like, I think that a lot of these universities, when they're exposed to the light of day, sunlight is a great disinfectant. So if you apply to have a speaker like me and your university refuses it, just get me the information and I'll have you on Fox News at night.
I do consider myself a member of the left, but I do like
listening. Thanks for coming again.
I like listening to you, just like I like listening to Milo, whom I think you should debate at some point. I like listening to people from all over the spectrum, so I can have a better idea of where I stand, and so I can take information, be mm-hmm. objective about it. I find myself agreeing with a lot of the things your friend Dave Rubin says, where mm-hmm. you're as annoyed by the people who think everything is racist and everything is sexist as you are by the people who, you know, want to kick out immigrants. I think most people...
The people who are on the left get to go first. And so, don't worry, I won't eat your soul right now.
So if y'all have a question, please, first of all, being civil and being professional is key here, so everyone can get their questions in. Q&A is going to go up to 7:30, so this is, like, we have to be very efficient here. One thing that this room does not have is, like secondary microphones. So what we're going to do is, if I can have two people line up on each row,
and then we're just going to alternate back and forth. After one person asks a question, you can sit, and then someone else in like this half, for example, can get behind. Don't fight. Like, we're going to get to everyone, hopefully.
And if you can't hear the questions, I'll repeat them on the mic so people can hear.
Exactly. So if you all can hold the line, we'll start on this half.
Okay, you were quick. Go for it.
Hi, I'm a member of YCT. Thank you for coming to our campus, first of all. I've been thinking about a question I was going to ask you for a couple of days now, and I figured I'd ask something that you may not have been asked before. I like to pride myself on being probably the most right person in this room. And so, when it comes to
second most right today, go ahead.
When it comes to the issue of Black Lives Matter, I've looked at the statistics, and I, by and large, understand the arguments against most of the things they say, but when it comes to the issue of a government's responsibility to interface with their citizens in a way that they feel protected by it, do you think that the group has an argument there?
Well, I mean, I think that the idea that the government does not do that, that's what a democracy is. I mean, the idea that the police aren't talking to citizens is a misread of what the police actually do. It's not like the police pull up in headquarters and then they just run out and just attack people. That's not how the police work. So there is a feedback mechanism. And in a democracy, in a republic, there is a feedback mechanism that does exist. If people aren't listening properly, then that's something that we can work on. But the problem I have with Black Lives Matter is they base their false assumptions about what the police are on not listening to the police or recognizing what the police are. They say that the police, they're not worried about the police listening, they're worried about the police actually policing. They think that the police in arresting people who commit crimes are doing something deeply wrong if they're not arresting people by race. If there are too many black people being arrested, then the police are racist and doing something that's deeply evil and wrong. That's the problem I have with Black Lives Matter. I don't have any problem with people who want to talk to the cops. I don't think the cops have any problem with people who want to talk to them. I think they have more problems with the people who are pushing the notion that cops are racist and blowing away people for no good reason. And they have a real problem with people who are rioting in cities based on that false logic.
Thank you.
Okay, so my question is a little bit different from the main topic that we're talking about.
Yeah, anything.
So I'm sure you've heard about what happened to Brock Turner this summer. And
yeah, it's Stanford.
Yeah.
I'll admit I didn't follow super closely, but probably.
But after this happened and like all the backlash against it, Stanford passed a rule that like they can't have any hard alcohol on campus, like in the party center.
Mm-hmm.
So like, what do you think of that? Like their ruling and like.
I mean, I think it's a stupid prophylactic measure. I mean, I think that. You know, the idea that anybody who has hard alcohol is then going to become a rapist is bizarre to me. You know, we already have laws against rape, it turns out. We already have laws against sexual assault. And if people want to get drunk, it's not something that I'm very much for, but it's also not something that I think the government has a role in, or the university really has a strong role in, unless it's actually endangering people. Like, if there's a bout of alcohol poisoning, and you personally are one of the people who poisoned yourself, and now they want to suspend you, then that's probably, the university is a private university, can set its own rules. But I think that these sort of we're going to stop rape by stopping people from drinking. You're big boys and big girls. I think that you're capable of making decisions for yourself, and I think that we're all capable of saying people who rape are bad,
yeah,
regardless of how much alcohol we have in their system.
So you don't think that like it's actually going to have an effect on like rape?
No, I don't think that rapists rape people because they're drunk. I think rapists rape people because they're rapists.
Hi, huge fan. you said in one of your talks, I think the fundamental problem is we, as Americans, we need a moral reawakening.
Yes.
And I absolutely agree with that. And I think kind of that was what the core of your talk and your arguments really are, is, hey, this is what is morally right, obviously, and this is what is morally wrong, obviously. And I agree with that. But what I've come to experience, and I just kind of wanted to get your opinion on, is those arguments, this is what is obviously moral against this is what is obviously immoral. When we're talking to these you know, people of the left, they will simply disagree. They will simply just disagree. And what I kind of want to bring it back to is it's really, in my opinion, more of a philosophical issue.
No, it's definitely a philosophical difference. Yeah.
It's really
the idea or the concept of
that I meet and speak to are somewhere in the middle where you don't want to fit yourself into any narrative. I think there are a lot of people like that, and I think society right now is in a phase where everybody just wants to be extreme. You either want to assume that everybody's racist or none
of these.
Whereas I think they're not being honest with themselves. Do you think, in your honest opinion, there's a way we can, as a society, come forward and sort of bridge those people together?
Yes, I think most people, and this is why I keep coming back to the individual versus grouping. And when I say left and right, I'm using these as shorthand for political viewpoints, but I'm not talking about necessarily people, unless I cite a specific person who is of the left because this is their view. But the fact is that the only way that we're going to be able to come together is around certain instances of injustice. Individual justice is actually really a pretty simple thing for people to agree on. It's when you get to this stupid concept of social justice. Social justice is the opposite of individual justice because justice doesn't need a modifier, right? Social justice is the idea that O.J. Simpson should have been let off because something bad happened with Rodney King, right? That's not individual justice, that's social justice. Social justice is the idea that your membership in an identity group means more than your responsibility for your own actions. When it comes down to individual responsibility, I think most people largely agree on what people should be responsible for on an individual level. And then when you see somebody do something bad, right and left, we all go, okay, well, that person ought to be punished. And when somebody does something good, I think we all right and left say that person ought to be rewarded. There should be a reward attached for that, and there usually is. The problem that I see is when all of that is obscured by an attempt at tribal identity. And you see this even on the right sometimes from the alt-right crowd, for example. You know, I think that it's really negative when you allow group identity to overwhelm individual rights in individual scenarios. That's the bridge is going to be how we treat each other as individuals, which is why I always keep coming back to decency.
Thank you.
Hello, Ben. Nice to talk to you. It's like a real life mailbag. So I have a question for you. Something I always struggle with understanding is the left's embrace of Islam. Because here you have, in political Islam, an ideology that is fundamentally opposed to so much what the left reports, yet you see the left increasingly promote, on a scale of, like, it happens in Europe with BBC News, it happens with our mainstream media with CNN, constantly putting out pro-Islam love pieces, etc.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this is related. The increasing criticism among particularly our cultural figures of Israel and growing anti-Israel sentiment. I've seen it on campus when people just try to voice appreciation for the country of Israel. There'll be Marxists that come after them, the sort of...
there's a reason Bernie Sanders is very anti-Israel.
The Islamic organization is around the protests as well, of course. What motivates this alliance?
So it all comes back to, all you have to remember about the left, really, when it comes down to it, is that fairness about an idea. So what happens is, think about it from the perspective, that's your only priority. And you look at the world today, and what you see is that the wealthy countries are all Western European countries steeped in Judeo-Christian civilization, or at least raised in Judeo-Christian civilization if they've moved away from it. And then Islamic countries are dirt poor, right? The people there are in serious trouble. They have leadership that's absolutely awful, authoritarian, brutal to women, brutal to homosexuals, just awful across the board. And what the left sees when they see that is not, why are those governments doing that to those poor people? Or why is this philosophy of radical Islam doing that to impoverished women and children? Like, why are they doing that? What the left instead sees is, hey, look, the rich person, the poor person, the rich person screwed the poor guy. Right? It was colonialism, it was imperialism, the West was colonialist and imperialist, they were too powerful. That's why these other countries are poor. Saudi Arabia is poor, even though it's not really. Saudi Arabia is poor because of the West. The Palestinians are poor because of Israel, right? It's always in opposition to something. It's never, maybe the Palestinians are poor because their leadership keeps stealing all their money and they keep voting for terrorists, right? Like, that would probably be a better explanation as to why they're consistently poor and engaging in terrorism. But instead of looking at the responsibility of the people who are actually making the decisions, they look to the global inequality. That's why they focus on things like the same drive that leads them to focus on income inequality as opposed to how do we make life better for poor people. Those are two separate questions, right? Income inequality is a stupid idea because who cares if one guy's rich and one guy's poor? I only care if the guy who's poor is poor. I'd like him to be richer, right? But the left sees a fixed pie in the world, and therefore, if one group is poor and one group is rich, the rich screw the poor. So there's a heroic poverty to the Islamic world that the left identifies with.
Thank you.
And that overcomes all of their objections about the radicalism. In fact, they blame the radicalism on us, right? The radicalism isn't the fault of Islam or radical Islam. The radicalism is our fault for having victimized these poor Islamic people, and then they've been relegated to poverty and brutality because of us. That is why President Obama goes on an apology tour right after he's elected. Because the idea is if you just relieve that notion that America is the big bad Satan, then everything will be all better. And if we redistribute resources, things will be all better. That's why the left identifies on a consistent basis with some of the worst people on earth.
Thank you.
Hey, I appreciate you coming. I appreciate hearing you speak. And I try not to subscribe to any ideology. And that's why I like listening to you, because I think you're actually going